In this video, I'm going to hack a cheap doorbell and integrate it into Home Assistant. Make sure you stick around, and if you like what you see, hit subscribe button below so you don't miss out on future videos. Hi, I'm Will from Will Surridge Tech, and today we're going to look at a cheap doorbell that I bought from Wilko and hack it to make it smart. We're going to stick a Wemos D1 Mini in the back of it and integrate it into Home Assistant. We can then look at using Node Red to make it do some smart things. Let's get going. Let's start off by having a look at the doorbell. I got this doorbell from Wilkinson's for £12. I could have got a slightly cheaper one, but this one came with both a mains powered receiver and a battery powered receiver. I thought it'd be interesting to have a look at them both to see how the circuitry differed and see which one might be easier to hack later on. Let's start off having a look at the mains powered receiver. We're going to try it out and see how it functions normally. It appears to have an LED that's always on and a speaker that chimes when the button is pressed. Let's take it apart. I'm going to take it apart and have it plugged in. This is obviously dangerous because the live components will be bare. If you're not comfortable playing with mains voltage, then don't do this. We can confirm with our voltmeter that the LED stays at a constant voltage throughout and it doesn't change when you hit the doorbell. We can also check the voltage that our transformer outputs. In my case, it's outputting 12 volts. This is useless because we want to power our Wemos D1 Mini, which runs at 5 volts. So all in all, we can't tell if the doorbell has been rung using an LED easily. We can't power our D1 Mini from the power supply built in, and we'll be fiddling around with mains voltages. Why bother doing that? Let's have a look at the battery powered receiver instead. This version also has an LED and a speaker, but the LED only turns on when the doorbell is rung. Ideal! It also runs on two AA batteries, which is 3 volts. Ideal! And if we remove these batteries, we have a nice compartment to sit our Wemos D1 Mini in. Ideal! If we have a look inside, there's a really nice circuit board where everything that we need access to is attached by tails. The power in, the LED out, and the speaker out. Power's going to be easy. We're going to power our D1 Mini using a USB cable, and then we're going to attach the ground pin and the 3.3 volt pin on our D1 Mini to the power supply of our receiver. Now we can have a look at the LED. This is how we're going to know if the doorbell has been rung. We want to check the voltage on both pins of the LED using the ground of the D1 Mini as reference. You would expect your voltages to go from 0 volts when the LED is off to about 3.3 volts when the LED is on. Mine, however, is a bit different. Both of my pins start at 4.5 volts when the LED is off. And then when the LED is on, one of the pins drops to 2.5 volts. This obviously creates a potential difference to allow the LED to light up, but is not very useful when it comes to determining how we can use our Wemos D1 Mini to detect that. Unfortunately, it means we're going to require a bit more soldering than I'd have hoped. If your LED is normal and it starts at 0 volts and then goes up to a 3.3 volts or something like that, then you can just connect your D1 Mini pin directly to one of the pins on the LED that changes, and you can detect whether it goes high or low like that. If you have a strange setup like mine, then you're going to need a PNP transistor and a small resistor. I'm using 560 ohms. We're going to connect the emitter of the transistor to the anode of the LED, or a positive constant high voltage source. We're going to connect the base through our 560 ohm resistor to the cathode of the LED. And then we're going to connect our collector to the pin on the D1 Mini. We're going to need a pull-down resistor to avoid any noise on our circuit. I'm going to use pin D8 on my D1 Mini, as this has a pull-down resistor built in. We're going to solder the transistor directly onto the LED on the circuit board. And then we're going to attach a long tail to come out to connect to the D1 Mini later on. Make sure these tails are long enough, you can always cut them down later. If we connect the doorbell's power supply to the 3.3 volt pin on the D1 Mini, and the ground to the ground pin, and then we connect our new tail to the LED on pin D8, we can test it out. I'd recommend using a breadboard for now, or any form of crimp connector, just to try it out. We can always tidy it up and make a permanent connection later on. we need to plug the USB into the computer and head over to ESPHome. Once here, we can add a new device, naming the node, selecting the board type as a Wemos D1 Mini, entering our Wi-Fi SSID and password, and clicking Submit. We can then compile and download our binary. Once we've got it downloaded, we open up ESPHome Flasher, select the right serial port, select the right binary that we've just downloaded, and click Flash. Once the pink Wi-Fi information appears on the screen, you can close it down and test it out. After this, we head back over to ESPHome, as we need to add a sensor. If we go to the ESPHome website, we can see under binary sensors, there's some YAML that we can copy. If we paste this into our configuration file, we change the name to Doorbell, change the pin to D8, and add a pin node for a pull-down resistor. Once happy, we can save it, validate it, and upload it over the air to our D1 Mini. Once that's happened, we can head over to our integrations and see it. It should appear automatically in the integrations, but if it doesn't, you can add it using the big plus at the bottom right and searching for ESPHome. In here, you add the IP address of your new device, and then it should pop up. If we click through, we can see the doorbell sensor listed as a binary sensor. If we hit the button on our doorbell, then the binary sensor should go from off to on. If that works, we can move on to the next feature of our doorbell, controlling the speaker. For this, we're going to add a switch to pin D4. We're going to compile it and upload it over the air to our D1 Mini. Once that's happened, we should see that the switch is listed as a new entity under our device in our integrations. Now we can play with the circuitry. For this, we're going to need an NPN transistor. We're going to connect it in series with our speaker. So the emitter will be connected to the speaker wire, the collector will be connected with the speaker terminal, and the base will be connected to pin D4 on our D1 Mini. If the base pin is high, then the signal can flow between the collector and the emitter, and the sound should happen. If the pin D4 is low, then no signal will flow, and no sound will come out. But the binary sensor should still detect, and the LED should still light up. We can now test out in Home Assistant, checking that the sound plays when the switch is on, and the sound doesn't play when the switch is off. If that works, we can put it all together. Now my battery compartment isn't actually big enough for my D1 Mini using header pins, so I'm going to solder my cables directly onto the D1 Mini. I'm going to need to drill a hole through the battery compartment for the cables to come through, and another hole out to the side for my USB cable to come in. With a lot of jiggery-pokery, and a bit of cable extension, hindsight's unkind, it should all fit and it should all work. It's worth testing it out again now to double check that nothing's come loose during this process. There's no point in having a smart doorbell if all we're going to do is turn the sound on and off. So let's head over to Node Red and create some automations. I want my doorbell to notify my phone when the doorbell is rung, and also to announce a text-to-speech alert on my Google Home Mini, but only if the sound is turned on the doorbell. We're going to need an event state node, a current state node, and two call service nodes. The event state node will trigger the automation if the doorbell is on, i.e. the doorbell has been rung. The current state node will determine if the doorbell sound is on, and so whether to trigger the text-to-speech alert or not. Now the first call service node is going to be our text-to-speech. We're going to trigger the text-to-speech on our Google Home Mini and set the message to the message we want it to play. In our second call service node, we want to do the same thing, but using the notify function on the phone app. Once we're happy, we can link it all together and deploy it. We can test it out. If the doorbell sound is off, then you should just get a notification on your phone. If the doorbell sound is on, then it should also trigger a text-to-speech alert on the Google Home Mini. And there we go, a cheap doorbell turned smart. Make sure you hit subscribe below so you can find out more about my smart tech and how you can build yourself the ultimate smart home.